All right, everybody, welcome back to this 69th episode of the REBT Advocates with Dr. Michael R. Edelstein of 3minutetherapy.com, psychologist in the San Francisco Bay Area, and me, Tommy Bateman, counselor extraordinaire in Richmond, Virginia. You can write us both at just REBTAdvocates at gmail.com, REBTAdvocates at gmail.com. But before we introduce the topic for today, Michael, you have a couple of very exciting announcements. What's going on?
Yeah, we have two interesting and competent authors coming up. Next week, we have Elliot Cohn, and Elliot wrote this great book on REBT called Making Peace with Imperfection, and Discover Your Perfectionism Type, End the Cycle of Criticism, and Embrace Self-Acceptance. So he takes a somewhat different approach than we usually do, and that is the underlying problem with all emotions, emotional disturbance, is perfectionism. And he makes a strong case for that. So that'll be interesting. And then the following week, let's say today's the 11th. So Elliot will be on the 18th. And then Warren Farrell will be on the 25th. And he wrote The Boy Crisis with John Gray. John Gray of Men Are From Mars, Women Are From Venus. And Warren's also had a number of books on the New York Times bestseller list. And his subtitle is Why Our Boys Are Struggling and What We Can Do About It. So that'll be very interesting, especially from an REBT perspective.
So that is excellent. Guys, the advocates, we're getting them on. Thank you guys for subscribing, because that's the sort of thing that makes this sort of thing possible. So on to our topic. We have in REBT a tradition of being very, very careful with our words. And in fact, last week's guest, Marty Nemko, brought up some words and we were like, well, no, we don't quite do that. And this word in this case is replace. Now, I'm guilty. When I teach inmates and when I teach my clients how to do REBT, sometimes I say, okay, so we look at our irrational belief and it says, I must do well. Well, what we should do is replace the must with the word prefer. I prefer to do well. We replace. Michael, where have I gone wrong?
Okay, very good. Very good. I was looking forward to discussing this with you since we have different perspectives on this. And when I hear therapists talk about replacing preference with a must, it sounds like CBT rather than REBT. You just replace it instead of saying, I absolutely must do well. You say, I prefer to do well. And it ignores the deep philosophical difference between the two and also where must come from. Because we're not really replacing one word with another. What we're doing is teaching you to develop an entirely new philosophy of life where you question, challenge, and contradict your musts and shoulds. And lo and behold, if you do that, and you banish them, what do you find in its place or underneath it are your preferences. So suppose you eat a peach and you finish eating the peach and there's a peach pit. Did you replace the peach with a pit? I don't think most people would describe it that way. They'd say, well, I got to the pit because I ate the peach around it. Or suppose you take off all your clothes and lo and behold, you're nude. Would most people say, well, I replaced my clothes with my nudity? That's normally what we say, because your nudity was there all the time. It was under your clothes, and the peach pit was there all the time. It was under the it was inside the peach. And the same way with your preferences and demands, the preference is there all the time. And in fact, the reason you have demands is because you escalate the preferences, which are human and you have all the time, into musts and shoulds. You convince yourself, because I prefer to do well, I absolutely must. Or because I prefer you to treat me well, you absolutely must. Or because it would be desirable if life were fair, easy, and hassle-free, it must. So what we want you to do is get rid of the musting philosophy, the demanding philosophy, and then reinforce the preferences it came from. So that's my basic argument about replace.
Michael, you're wrong, because really, my Dr. Ellis, he taught ABCRF. ABC, we already know what ABC is, replace effective new feeling. Obviously, that's what's going on. No, I see your point. What you're doing is saying if I teach replace must with prefer, well, I'm just skipping straight to the end. I didn't go through the process, the D process and the E process of really whittling down the exact reason why that original B is irrational. I'm just imposing the new preference on there. I'm just imposing that new belief without saying, guys, this is the process we got to it. And, you know, if we can argument and debate and dispute the reasons why that original mustiness was so inappropriate, you'll come to a much greater understanding of why that preference is so much more true. Is that kind of the thrust here?
Yes, you will see that. You'll be able to get in touch with your preferences, which are clouded by your musts and shoulds. Mm-hmm. Your thinking will be clearer because you'll be acting on the underlying preferences rather than the musts and shoulds. And also, you'll be able to discover what your values are without the musts and shoulds, because then you don't have these extra layers or what someone else thinks or what society thinks, because you're making them into demands, musts and shoulds. So that is another benefit of doing this. Also, sometimes people criticize or dismiss REBT on the grounds that, well, so you don't say must, you say I prefer, you're replacing one with another. It's just semantics. So REBT is just semantics. Now, the word semantics really doesn't refer just to the word, but more importantly, it refers to the deep meanings behind the words. So if I say that lion is just a picture of a lion, well, it's just semantics, but you're not going to start running if it's just a picture of a lion. It's not a real life lion. So semantics words have deep meanings, and that's their usefulness. So yeah. It is just semantics, actually.
Yeah.
It is the meanings behind the words. So dismissing REBT as just semantics really has those both of those problems.
Yeah, I think it's really interesting that you say that when we're about to have Dr. Cohn on next week, Elliot for short. I know him, whatever. But that's what a philosopher would say, right? That philosophy is the practice of debating the meaning of words, or getting down to the meaning of words to begin with. And REBT at its core is a philosophical practice in so many ways. Maybe I'm not being semantically precise in that, but I think it works. It has a new philosophy. That's what we teach in REBT, which is semantic in its core. And what does any other talk therapy do, really? So that's great. Now, Michael, you said that that saying doing this replacing stuff is a little bit like CBT. What led you to say that?
Well, because that's a good question. And I see CBT as not philosophical, mm-hmm. but rather more mechanical, more mechanistic, and you don't develop a deep philosophy. You just have some techniques to get better, techniques such as identifying the distorted thought, not that there's an underlying major thought, the musts and shoulds that give rise to these distorted thoughts. So REBT is qualitatively different than CBT in that major way. Also, REBT, in line with it being philosophical, shows you that people are never bad, they're never evil, they can do bad things. So this is a different philosophy of how you view people. When you learn REBT, you see people in a very different way. You see them as just people doing things, some bad, some good, not devils or demons walking around. So that's another implication of the philosophy. One last point in trying to illustrate the problem in using replace. Suppose you're a theist and you become an atheist, or you're an atheist and you become a theist. You don't just replace the idea of no God with God or vice versa. Normally you change because you think about it. You think about the philosophies involved and what they mean and their implications. And so when you make that change, usually it's a process. It doesn't happen overnight. Well, I replaced God with no God, or I replaced atheism with theism, anything like that. But you think it through, and it's a deep process. It involves repetition, reinforcement, as Tommy said, questioning, asking yourself the evidence for these things, and doing it that way. Tommy, do you have any final last words?
No. I have some gripes about the philosophy of human beings in general, but that's a religious thing, and I'm going to leave it alone because it has nothing to do with replacing. I think we're going to end the episode right now.
Okay, and just another last thing, which is if you enjoyed the episode or you didn't agree with it, put that in your comments below. Questions also are welcome. And give us a like, and please subscribe to the REBT Advocates to stay on the rational side of life.